All right, how y'all doing, New Image Church? Come on, say hallelujah. Man, my God has been so good to me.
Amen.
Has God been good to you?
Woo, yes. Amen.
Come on, let's just say that church chant. God is good.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good. Amen. We're going to work on that. Y'all doing all right this morning? It's good to see you in the house of the Lord. Do you believe this is the house of the Lord?
Amen.
The very presence of an eternal, everlasting Father has set his presence in this place this morning. And it's not because of these four walls. It's not because of this great sound equipment or these awesome lights that we have. It's because his people, his children, have stepped into this place. Amen. Do you believe that?
Absolutely.
You are the catalyst for the very presence of God here on this earth. It's so good to see so many of you here this morning. Welcome to New Image Church. You guys feeling all right? All right? That's good. Listen, we're not working on a feeling up here.
Amen.
Even if I do feel good, I feel all right. Maybe you don't know. You can't see my insides. You don't know how I feel.
That's right.
But I got a joy deep in my soul.
Oh, yes.
His name is Jesus Christ.
Oh, yes.
Man, I just love the name of Jesus. There's some power in the name of Jesus. Is there anybody who believes that in here? Power in the name of Jesus. So listen, I'm speaking to your situations and to your circumstances this morning. If you're watching online, we welcome you. I'm speaking to your situations. They're not going to hold you down anymore. Jesus has already won that victory. I need somebody in their mind to grab onto that right now. Jesus has already won that victory. If we got any believers in the house, can we stand to our feet all over this place, front, back, left, or right? And let's just go ahead and give him some praise with our voice, some hallelujah. Enter his courts with praise. That means if you want to start this thing right, go ahead and start it with some praise. Listen, go ahead and look at your wall, look at your enemy across the battlefield, and just go ahead and release some praise. Come on, church, release some praise. Hey, we're all praisers in this house this morning. We're all praisers. God, you are good. Come on, let's speak to him. God, you're good. Your mercy endures forever, God. Lord, in my mind, I see a timeline. I see a beginning and a middle and an end. But Lord, you have no timeline. You work outside of that, God, and you see all. You know all. You have been to all places, Lord. You've been in my past. You've been in my present. And you've been in my future, God. And you will be there when I get there, Lord. And I thank you that I can trust you in this moment to do everything that you have planned to do, God. And Lord, I'm just going to ride the wave of your glory this morning. This church is going to ride the wave of your glory in this place. So God, we raise up a hallelujah, a highest praise to you and to you alone. You are worthy, you are worthy, you are worthy.
Oh God, we
so worthy.
Living God.
So God, your children, humble ourselves before you, Lord. Use us, use me, Lord. Use every single body in this place, Lord. Every sound wave, Lord, every stomp, every clap, Lord, let it break down walls. Let it tear down barriers, Lord, that were placed before. Color, race, everything, Lord, just break it all down. Anything that the evil enemy has set up, Lord, any principalities, any strongholds that the enemy has set up, Lord, we break against those things. We begin to push right now with a praise. So in this place this morning, on the count of three, I want you to give out the loudest praise. Come on, one, two, three. Hallelujah!
Yeah. Yeah.
Come on, clap your hands.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies.
Come on.
I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief.
Come on.
I raise a hallelujah. Weapon is a melody.
Yeah.
I raise a hallelujah.
Listen.
Heavy comes to fire.
Church, why don't you raise up one good hallelujah? Listen, I want to tell you, I want to tell you something right now. The enemy has come against you this past week.
That's right.
And he's meant to put you down. He's meant to put you under. That was his intention for you. He wanted to put you in the ground. But does anybody know?
Come on.
That because of Jesus.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Right.
Hey.
Oh, yeah.
Because of Jesus.
Right. Yes, yes, yes.
There ain't no grave gonna hold me down. Come on, somebody. There ain't no grave gonna. No grave's gonna hold me down.
When I hear that trumpet sound.
it to him.
Oh, here is a lion with a smooth and velvet tongue.
Yeah.
Oh, here is a tyrant. He's always telling me
testify.
Love is a resurrection.
Yeah.
Love is the trumpet sound.
Hey.
Love is my weapon. I'm gonna take the giant. There ain't no way. Gonna hold my body down. There ain't no way. Gonna hold my body down. When I hear that song sound. Was crucified. He went on down to hell, took back every key. He rose up as a lion, and now he set the captive free.
There
ain't no grave gonna hold my body down.
The grave, you can get out of the grave too.
Yes, amen.
Come on, Tiffany.
If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too.
Hey, yes. Come on, prophesy, prophesy.
If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too.
I'm walking with Jesus.
If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too.
Somebody, somebody.
If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too.
Come on, somebody, put your foot down and walk.
If you
times I'll say there ain't no grave.
There ain't no grave.
Good morning. You know, years ago, I used to stand up here and say, good morning, New Image.
Thank you,
Jesus. I'm going to change it up.
Come on.
Good morning, missionaries.
Hey.
We got any missionaries in the house? Yeah? We got any missionaries in the house?
Hallelujah.
If you profess and you love the Lord and He is your Savior, who are you? What are you? You're a missionary.
That's right.
You're called. You're commissioned to be a missionary. So welcome to the house, missionaries. Ain't no grave going to hold you down either.
Come on.
Right. Right.
Why is no grave going to hold you down? Because that love that He has is in you. And guess what you're going to do with that love? You're going to keep somebody else from being in that grave. That love is going to save somebody else because that love is inside of you. In May of 2014, that love saved me.
Yeah.
And it was true love that saved me. And that love that dwelt inside of Wormy tore my walls down. In May of 2014, I came to this church and I had walls built up and I didn't want to be here. I came reluctantly, and I met Wormy outside the old sanctuary, and I went to hold my hand out as a gentleman and shake his hand, and that didn't work, because his hand bypassed my hand, and he just embraced me. And he kissed me on the cheek, and he said, welcome, I love you. Man, that wrecked my world. That's what a missionary does. You've got that love inside of you.
That's right.
And you're going to tear down walls inside of somebody else. Those walls that have been built up for years, fighting that love of Christ, and you're going to tear them down with a simple hug, a simple kiss on the cheek. It starts with a smile. And I want to challenge every one of you to smile.
Yeah.
Because that smile radiates the love of Christ. In the workplace, smile. In the marketplace, smile. When you greet somebody coming in the door, smile. Just let them know that love is deep inside of you. Nothing better than a smile. You can change a smile at a gas station. Somebody pumping gas across from you. Just smile. You can change a life with a smile. I got some good news, missionaries. Saturday, March 9th, we will have our first meeting in the Hope Building. I've reserved it from 5 to 9. We'll probably start about 6 o'clock. We're going to have a meal. We're going to break bread together. We're going to socialize. We're going to love each other. We're going to get to know each other. We're going to have a meet and greet. Some of you I know, some of you I don't. And then I want to share my heart, the vision that the Lord's given me for this mission team. And then we're going to start moving forward. We're going to be missionaries. We're going to be missionaries here in our home. It starts in the home. You can't be a missionary abroad if you're not right at home. So we're going to be right at home. And once we're right at home, we're going to go out and we're going to take that love to the nations. Take that love to the nations. Those that are interested in joining the missions team, if you have an interest, if you're not sure, I have an email address. Please reach out to me. And it's simply Vaughn, V-A-U-G-H-N, at newimagechurch.com. Reach out to me. All communication for the missions team will go through the missions Facebook page. But I need to know you're interested. I'll add you to the group, and we will have all communication through that page. But I just need y'all to know once we get started, this train's moving, and we're not going to stop it.
Amen.
We're going to take this love. The world needs it. The world needs some love. The world needs some love. It needs it right here in Easley. It needs it right here in this house. Right here in Easley. Right here in the upstate. We're going to love the hell out of some people, let me tell you.
Come on.
That's what it's all about. So I challenge you with that smile. Show them pearly whites off. Challenge you with that smile. Everywhere you go, smile. Let people know that love is deep inside of you. Because sometimes that smile, they're going to look at you and say, man, that person's crazy. Why are they always smiling? Why is Wormy always smiling? He can't not smile. And the more they see it, the more they're going to want to know, what is that about him? I need to know what's going on inside of him. I know we went through some stuff a couple years ago. Why is he still smiling? It's because of who's in him. And who's in him can be in every one of you. And the world needs it. We need it. We need it. All right, we're going to go into offering. If the ushers could come forward. It's another challenge. A challenge for offering. It's tithe and offering. I know some people struggle with the thoughts of 10%. Man, 10% of everything I make. Man, I can't buy groceries if I give my 10%. Man, if I give that 10%, my power is going to be cut off. I can only do 2%. That's all I can do. And I just can't make it happen. If you're struggling with 10%, you're going to struggle with what I'm about to say. He says, give me my 10%. But what you don't realize is the other 90 says too. It's all his. If you struggle with the thought that the 10% is his, you're going to struggle with the fact that the other 90 is his too. Once you grasp the fact that it's all his, you got no problem giving what he's asked for. Because it's all his. He's blessing you with the 90. He says, I'll let you be my steward over that 90. My steward over my 90. And I'm not telling you anything that's not in the word. It's all right there. He says it's all his. From the heaven to the heaven of heavens, everything in the earth belongs to him. Got your tithe and offering ready. Father, I just pray right now for the heart of the giver, the heart of the tither, the heart of those that come to you joyfully and continue with the act of worship of giving, because it's all worship, Father. That 10% is an act of worship, an act of surrender. Giving it to you, saying, Father, I know it's not mine, it's yours. You request the 10%, I'm going to give it to you willingly, lovingly, through worshipful heart. Father, I know the other 90 is yours, and I pray for guidance on how to be a steward over it so that, Father, you can continue to pour in abundance over and above more than I could even imagine. Father, as I test you like Malachi says, Father, I just stand there and worship in all to you because I know what your word says. Your word is truth, and I don't have to assume that it won't come true because you are truth, Father. Lord, I love you. In your holy name I pray. Amen.
There ain't no gray gonna hold my body down.
Got some believers out there? Hallelujah. Father, we bless your name. We recognize you, your presence. I love how you go behind me, you go before me. You've seen all my battles. You've already won the victory. And I trust in you. Come on.
You go before, I know.
Yeah.
That you've gone to win my war. And you come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call it my victory.
Is he the defender of your heart? Come on, church. Is he the defender of your heart? If he is, can you sing this next song right here? It says, the Lord is my shepherd. You say,
the Lord is my shepherd.
You believe that? He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Woo. Defender behind me.
Defender behind me.
Is there anybody who can say this? I won't fear.
I won't fear.
Hey. No, no. Because I'm filled with anointing. Hey. My cup's overflowing.
My cup's overflowing.
No weapon can harm me.
No weapon can harm me.
Ooh. I won't fear. Now, if you can get a little bit of confidence up, can you sing hallelujah, I am not alone?
And hallelujah, I am not alone.
Come on. He's your comfort, church.
And he's my.
This next part, he says,
he always guides me.
Hey, through mountains and valleys.
Woo. Mountains and valleys.
His joy is refreshing.
His joy is refreshing.
What's he do? Restores my soul. Yes, it does.
Restores my soul.
If you believe that, sing about this. Mercy and goodness.
Mercy and goodness.
You know, it gives me assurance.
Gives me assurance.
That I see his glory.
That I see his glory.
Face to face.
Face to face.
Yes, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
In hallelujah, I am not alone.
Oh, he's my comfort.
He's my comfort. Always holds me close.
That's real good, guys. That's real good. Can you help me sing this next part right here? This is truth.
Your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your peace. Your spirit lives with,
say this right here.
My victory, your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your peace. Your spirit lives within me, my victory.
Spirit,
so I will walk in your
He's my comfort.
True, come on and lift up some praise.
Scripture says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'll see if word can excite us then. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Amen.
We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Let's try one more. Oh, taste and see that the Lord, He is good. I'm just trying to see which way I got to go today.
Hallelujah.
Because if the word don't excite us, ain't nothing I can say or do for us.
That's right.
There's nothing I can say or do, so I'm not going to even sit and try and pump or prime. If the word don't excite, then nothing will. The Bible tells us that we're supposed to enter in with certain expectations and certain praises. And if it requires someone telling us to do it, then to me it's not real.
Oh yes, speak it, yes.
It's real to me when I can think of the goodness of Jesus
that's
and all that He has.
Right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Now if God hasn't done anything for you, then you ought not give Him anything.
That's right.
So we're gonna take about 30 seconds to think about what God has done. So now my question is, as we go into a different part of service, is what you just gave God a reflection of what you need from Him? What you just offered Him, is that a direct reflection of what you need from Him? Because if you didn't offer Him anything, then that means you're telling Him you don't need anything from Him. Okay. So we'll leave that right. Again, I was in the young adult class on Wednesday night, and they were talking on meat and milk. And I told them I preached a sermon before, and I'm going to have to pull it back out. And it was entitled Lactose Intolerant. And how, as a believer, as a Christian, as a pastor, it should make me sick to my stomach when I see people not growing. We're going to leave that there. Y'all may be seated. I tell you, I'm going to provoke today and possibly make upset But at the end of the day, when I leave, I go home. And as long as I do God's work, that's all that matters. We bless God on today. Let's give that praise team a hand clap of praise. Seniors are young at heart, I should say. I found a group that's almost as bad as you all. That wreaks almost as much havoc as you guys do. That, you know, y'all almost got us kicked out of Capri's. And I believe I found a group that was almost that close, Wormy. I mean, y'all still got them. I mean, hands down, the younger heart definitely is the most radical group here at the church. But those folks from the praise team, one in particular, I've never seen someone so smart. See, he got the mic first, and he was supposed to call me out, but he didn't. You ought to know I'm going to call you out. It don't matter. There was one young man that weighs probably 117 pounds, and that's with layers of clothes on soaking wet. And this guy, when I came to the table, this guy had a salad. I'm like, okay, that's how he stays so fit. Then he had some, he said it was mushrooms, but it looked like oysters. I don't know what it was. And I'm thinking like he's eating healthy. Good job. And then this group of people come out of the back. And it's like seven of them. And they all got four plates. And they all came and sat it down in front of this gentleman. And I'm thinking he ordered for us all. I'm like, man, that's sweet of you. He said, no, this is my food. And that gentleman is none other than Pastor Blake. Perfect timing. You missed your opportunity. I've never in my life seen someone so small eat so much. I think he thought he had his entire family with him. But we bless God. Listen, after we were done, you saw what happened, how God used them, and they sung songs of praise. And it was just, that's what this year is all about. It's not about doing the norm. It's not about doing, it's about doing things different and touching a different group. Again, it is not my goal, it's not the other pastor's goal for us to go rob another church of their members. There's too many folks out there that don't know church, that don't know God. So there's enough folks out there that don't know him that we can go and reach. So that's what we're trying to do this year. So again, we're focusing on go get it, and we are blessed. I thank you guys for the testimonies on last week. Man, I'm telling you, it seemed like every day this week, last week I got someone calling and texting or something telling me how either they knew someone personally by the name of Timmy or Timothy, or they knew this or whatever the case may be. And we're grateful that God spoke to you, and we're excited about some things that God is doing. You know, I was blessed when Vaughn said something in particular. He spoke of home first. And I'm a firm believer. I don't knock any, you know, I don't knock any ministry, but I'm a firm believer if home ain't taken care of, you can't go take care anywhere else. And it's too much needed home. Right here, last week, and many of you didn't even realize there was a drug rehabilitation center here with us last week. We had no clue they were going to be here, and the testimonies that came from them, and we're happy that God opened door for us to go and minister there with them and share the gospel. So God is doing some great things in church right now, and we ought to be excited. So if you don't have anywhere to plug in, it's because you don't want to plug in. I told you I'm going to provoke you today. I don't expect too many high fives today. If you don't have anywhere to plug in, it's because you're happy with being a loner and not finding anything to do. Yesterday, we went to the boys and girls home, and two of the young men from Relentless was able to be a blessing to the kids there. And oftentimes, we look down on these folks, and we don't realize that they need God, too. So we were grateful on what God did on yesterday, and with the expectation of God doing greater on today. How many showed up today because you have to show up on a Sunday? I don't expect too many to raise their hand, but that's truthful. There's many of us here because you have to be here. You don't even feel right if you don't come to church. Then there's some that woke up this morning that said, I just got to get into the house of the Lord. So we're going to speak to you briefly on today about some very particular things God is doing. Last week, again, we started off with Go Get Timmy, speaking of go get it and go and get those that are lost. And on today, we're going to continue to do with that theme, go get it. But today, we're going to switch up the topic just a little bit. Today's topic is going to be lessons on dating. It's David's turn. Lessons on dating. It's David's turn. Lessons on dating. It's David's turn. Now, do we have any Davids in the house? Oh, we do. Oh, we do have a David. David, but you're sitting next to your significant other, right? Okay, so we're safe. This is not to you. We don't want to get David in trouble. No, any other David in here? We don't want to get David in trouble, so you can use another name if you have to. But today we're coming from 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. 1 Samuel, 16th chapter. We're going to look at verse 11 through 13. You know, I did my research and found the correct pronunciation of things and how you pronounce these folks' names. And I promise you I'm going to jack it up either way. So it's all good. So he asked Jesse. I hear something still flipping. You don't hear that sound, you know, often anymore. And it is a good sound to hear when you hear the Bible flipping. I'm telling you, you don't hear it often. And I'm guilty. My study time, you know, but when I'm up here, I'm guilty of technology. But it's a great sound to hear those Bible pages turning. So he asked Jesse, are these all the sons you have? They're still the youngest, Jesse answered. He is tending to the sheep. Samuel said, send for him. There was a translation that I did not put up. I didn't realize there were so many translations, and I'm being honest. I remember Nikki Alexander told me she got one that's ERB. I think she said that's what it was, Easy Read Bible. There's a lot of, but I found one in my study that was the NET Bible. I still don't know what it means, but it was the NET Bible. New English translation. I'm like, I didn't know there was an old one, but New English translation. And in that particular part right there where it says, he tends to the sheep, Samuel said, send for him. In that particular one, it says, go get him. We will not sit down until he arrives. Next verse. So he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and he had a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, I'm going to pause real quick. Those of you that are married or those of you that have a significant other, that was your key just now to nudge him and say, he's talking about you. See, you just missed out on the extra gift for Valentine. Let me read that again and some of you will catch it this time. Just reach over. Don't rub his leg. Just tap him and tell him they're talking about you. So he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and he had a fine appearance. Good job. I seen you. Good job. That's what I'm talking about. Now you owe her something special for Valentine's Day. It was glowing with fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, rise and anoint him. This is the one. Rise and anoint him. This is the one. And I think we got one more verse. I can't even see. Who's working back there today? Okay. I still can't see who you are. I see you. Francine, that's you. Okay. So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brother. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Samuel then went on to Ramah. So we've read this story before. We've heard it before. We know this story, but hopefully we can point some things out that will bless you. Why did I say something about David? Years ago, again, before I say this, I can't tell you how many folks really asked me, was Timmy a real person? I was asked that so many times. Yes, he really was. He really was a real person. He's a person that I knew, that I know. He really is real. Now, some of the stuff was exaggerated. You know, I mean, just like just now when I said, you know, Pastor Blake had seven servants with four plates each. That was exaggerated. It was six with four. But so it was exaggerated just a little bit. But yes, Timmy was a real person, and he is a real person, and he is an apostle of God, and he's sharing the gospel and doing what God has for him to do. It is real. So this is a real person here too, David. Years ago when I moved to Easley back in when after I graduated in 2014, I moved to Easley in 2014 after I graduated high school. And some of the visitors and some that weren't here last week said, that's not possible. Work with me for a second. When I graduated in 2014, I moved to Easley. When I moved, the reason I moved to Easley because I worked at a dealership here in the Easley area. And God blessed me tremendously in this dealership. I excelled quickly at this place and did great. It was able to do great things. But in particular, one position, we had to hire a new service advisor. We had six different guys that we were looking at. And some were more skilled than others. And it's funny how the mind operates. See, listen, when we hire someone, an application doesn't tell us everything we need to know. It does tell us what you're capable of doing, but usually it doesn't tell us what you're not capable of. And it doesn't tell us the negative things about you. So that's the sad part, because we focus on the good stuff, but there comes a time, even in my walk and in my hiring process, where I had to really rely on what God was speaking to me versus what I saw on paper. Because truth be told, people can fudge paper and make paper look really good. Have you ever seen someone apply for a job and you just look at the paper and you're thinking like, wow, this person's going to be great. And they walk in and you're like, I had this happen to me. I'm like, what in the world? This can't be. I tell folks all the time, you know, I don't need you to tell me anything about you. I'm going to find out what I need to find out through the Holy Ghost. The Spirit itself will speak and tell me exactly what needs to be spoken, because people can convince you of anything, but if their actions don't line up, it's something totally different. So in this hiring process, we had several different candidates, and I'm going to need some men to help me on today. I'm going to call out some. I think Lindsay McKeever just pointed at her husband. So since she pointed at you, Ben, I need your help. Sean, I think Sabrina just pointed at you. You may be working security. Are you working security? If it is, if someone can fill in over there, that would be great. I'm sorry, but I need his help. I'm going to call you last. Good job. Perfect. Perfect. So I'm going to need you guys to come up here when I call your name, if you don't mind. Just come on up here with me. Let's see who else. I'm going to give Clark a break today. I'm not going to even bother him today. Yeah, he hadn't been home in a month, and we want to get him acclimated to God again. Oh, I'm really going to pick different folks this time. Travis, I need you. Yes, yes, yes. Travis, I need your help. Help me count. I need seven men. No, JJ, I'm always called. Who you point? You're pointing at Joey? Joey just left the stage. Come on, Joey. Come on, Joey. All right. Anyone else want to point out their significant other? Someone's pointing at you, oldest Alexander brother. Dennis. See, someone said Derek. Dennis. Or someone said really old. What? And I don't think it was one of your brothers. Okay, I need, how many more do I need? I need seven up here. Aaron. No, I'm going to let Aaron. Come on, Aaron. Who's Aaron? Powers. Where? Oh, he's hot. That's why I didn't write. He normally sits up here. Come on up here with me, Aaron. All right, I need one more. Why did my brother hide? Oh, he's filling in. Oh, okay, okay. I thought he hid over there. I was about to call him out. God, I couldn't get my son, so I was going to get him. Let's see. Who's going to be my last man? Help me. Pastor Paul. Pastor Paul's always working. Who's going to be my last? Who you point? Brother, they're pointing at you. I see people pointing from every direction at you. Your wife just gave you a compliment. Now they want you on stage. Now, who's the tallest out here? Ben? All right, so that's going to work. Ben, I need you to stand right here. Sean's the tallest. Well, Sean, they said you're the tallest, so they want you to stand right here. Ben, I need you to stand right next to Sean. All right, let's work on this height thing. Come on down some, Travis. Let's see where we're at now. Travis is next. All right, come on, Travis. Dennis, it's almost looking like you're about to be last. I'm not sure. So where we at now? Come on, work with me. Y'all can see better. I'm up. Who? Matthew, you're up next. Then Joey. Then Aaron. All right. I got that part and don't know what I'm doing next, but we're good. I'm just messing with you. This story is a very familiar story. Now, y'all going to have to stand with me for a little bit. About an hour. This story is a very familiar story to many. Again, you know, this, he had a work to do. You know, let me back up real quick. Samuel himself was grieving. And the reason he was grieving, and the Lord spoke to him and said, why are you sitting there mourning over the loss of a king? In other words, he's sitting there saying, stop complaining. Stop all your murmuring. Stop all that stuff. I need you to just stop worrying about all of that and go do what you're supposed to do. This was words that God spoke to me even last year. He said, stop complaining. Stop worrying. Stop murmuring to me. There's a work for you to do. And oftentimes we sit and look at what's not versus what is. And God told him right here in verse 1, he said, I need you to stop mourning because I've got something for you to do. And the sad part is what he's mourning over is something that he wants that God removed. Many of you right now are hurting based on something you want that God. What you don't understand is when God removes it, he removes it for a reason. 9 out of 10 is because I've got something better in store for you. But a lot of us can't receive the better that God has for us because we want to hold on to the little. It's a crying shame. You want to hold on, and I'll use what Vaughn was talking. You want to hold on to the 10 when God still gave you 90. And there's a lot of us holding on to things that we're supposed to let go of, and that's what's happening right here. So he says, I need you to do something. I need you to go and anoint the king. He says, well, if I go and anoint the king, they're going to kill me. He said, nope, well, take this right here, boom, boom, boom. This is what you're going to do. All right, we're where we need to be right now. So he comes there, and he tells Jesse, he said, Jesse, I need you and your kids to consecrate yourselves. And I need you to come with me because we're getting ready to prepare a sacrifice. So he said, Jesse, I need you to go and cleanse yourself. Spiritually cleanse yourself. Make sure you are clean and your boys are clean. And I need y'all to come on here so we can do this. So Jesse grabs his sons. And he went on to do what was supposed to be done. And Samuel sat there and said, okay, this is what I need. I need one of your sons to be anointed king. So the Bible says, if you back up just a little bit, the Bible says that the first one that when they arrived, that Samuel saw Eli. And he thought that this was going to be the one. Why? Because this one is strong. This one's mighty. Sabrina, I'm not hitting on your husband. I don't get down like that. This one's good looking. That's what the Bible says now. But not only is this one strong and this one this and this one's good looking, this one looks like Saul. I got to stop there for a second. There's too many of us wanting, and that's rules in dating. The first rule in dating is don't get what you just got rid of. There's too many of us looking for the same thing God delivered us from. If the signs are still the same signs, then 9 out of 10, he's going to do what the last one did to you. Stop thinking because I'm in God now, I'm getting ready to change him. Stop thinking like that because guess what? God removed that one for a reason. Now, it's sad when the church itself has that same mentality that because he looks like Saul and he acts like Saul, then it has to be him who God has called to take over. Listen. When God is sending someone to do a new thing, he's not sending someone to do a new thing that looks just like the old thing. Some of y'all are missing this. Yes, you're in the army. Yes, you're mighty. Yes, you're strong. Yes, you look like Saul. But guess what? You've got all the outward appearance, but you lack something on the inside. Listen, you can be strong, mighty, powerful, and all these different things, but without heart, you can't do nothing. I was telling, I got a little dog. Many of you don't know. My mother, we dropped her off to stay with my mother 7, 8, 10 years ago. I'm going back to get her. One day, I really am. She's this big. She's a little dog. But this little dog, Miss Shirley, you can't tell her she's not a Great Dane or a pony or something. We had her in obedience school. She got kicked out of obedience school. How do you get kicked out of school? A dog. Because we're in there with Rottweilers and Great Danes and all these big dogs, and everyone's sitting down being quiet. And little pumpkins are like, shut up. Everyone else is behaving and she's not behaving. You got the shock collar on it hitting her, and she's just trying to bite the collar. She was just disturbed. But she would run up, I don't care how big you are, Sean, she would run up if she had to, and she would try to fight you. She would get beat and turn around and come back again. She had heart. Dumb as all ever, but she had heart. This first one, mighty, looks like him. This is what the people want. Now, if you go back, the people chose Saul. God said, I'm not going to allow you to do the same thing twice. I gave you what you wanted, and what you wanted got you to a certain point, and that's all they could do. So now it's time for what you want to move on, and I'm bringing in what I need. So this time, I'm going to appoint someone. I'm going to appoint someone to take this where it needs to go, but some of you won't jump on board because it don't look like Saul. Oh, yeah. Don't expect for this one to go over well. So, the first one comes. His name, Eliab. His name represents something. His name represents God, his father. So, he's got the name and the appearance. When he looks at him, Jesse looks at him. When Samuel looks at him, he says, you know what? He ain't the one. Although he should be, he is not the one. The reason why he's not the one is because that's not what I need for you. Some of you get upset when God tells you that that guy ain't the one. You get mad at God. And then when he turns around and hurts you, you're mad at God. God, why did you give me this man? He said, I told you not to fool with him. Then you turn around and say, but I just needed a friend. I get tired sometimes. I want to be loved. I want to go on a date. I want someone to tell me I'm this and that. God said, okay, so you chose it. Now you deal with the consequences. He may look the part. He may this, that, and the other, but he's not what I have for you. So the first one again, he says, you know what? I don't need you. You look like him, but I don't need you, brother. You got to go. Second brother. Again now, this is how Jesse has his sons on display. The same way you guys are looking at them, and the same way they're sitting up here saying, you know what, all these people looking at me, I feel uncomfortable. That's how Jesse's sons were on display, just like that. So now you have the second son that looked like he could be one of... Cut your hair. You lost your power. You're Lindsay, not Delilah, right? He just lost his, took his power away. I just messed with you. Some of y'all looking like, what is he talking about? Read your Bible. Read your Bible. Someone's about to look it up now. Go ahead, look it up. Figure it out. Samson. Spell it any way you want to. So now you got the second son that shows up, and he's Abinadad, and his name is Father of a Vow, or Willingness is what his name represents. The first son looked like Saul. Second son really don't look like Saul. If he didn't cut his hair, he may. But he don't really look like Saul. But he has something that the other didn't have. He has heart. Now, if you back up in scripture real quick, he told him, he said, I don't need this particular one right here because this one here don't do it. But the Lord said to him, he said, but the Lord said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height, for I rejected him. The Lord does not look at things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord look at the heart. Some of you can't find the right man because the right man's sitting there knocking on your door, but because he don't look like he work at Chippendales, man, I can't fool with y'all. He don't look like he worked at Chippendale, and he doesn't have a six-pack, and he doesn't have this, that, and the other. You don't want to be with him. Sit right there. That six-pack ain't going to keep you warm at night. You need a keg. All right, fool with y'all. Let me get back here. Them guys are high-fiving saying, yeah. My wife got it all of this, yeah. So the second one comes and he doesn't look like, but he has what God says. He has the heart. Now, what I love about God, and I wish people that were Christians, Christ-like, operated more like God, God looked past all the imperfections, and he looks at the heart. He doesn't look at the jealousy. He doesn't look at, and I'm just going to be honest, and some going to try and debate it. He don't even look at all the sins that we look at. God don't sit there and dwell on none of that. He goes source. He goes straight to the source. He looks at the heart of the man to try to figure out what this person is. And now I can use someone with the right heart, because the right heart means the right intentions. Now, some of you are grabbing again. The Chippendale dancer that spends more time in the mirror than you do. Don't be looking at your husband if he's a pretty boy. The Chippendale dancer that spends more time in the mirror. That's not you, is it? Okay. I'm just making sure. When in all reality, you should be looking at. Did you just point at Brooke? Oh. I thought she was being like this right here. I need someone with a heart. Now comes Ben. Abinadad. He's got heart. But he's still not the one. Oftentimes we go and do what we feel God wants. And we feel like we follow the direction to a T. And because we don't receive what we're supposed to receive, we feel like God lied. But God said, I have one that's there. Not necessarily what you think is the right one. I've got the right one there. So, Abinadad, you look the part and you have the heart. But you're not the one. Sorry. He looked hurt. Rub his back when he gets back there. I think he's really hurt. So now, we've got a few sons left. The Bible does something really crazy. It mentions the next one. They just turned the heat up. Y'all feel it? Now y'all see what I talk about up here? Okay. I'm not crazy. It's hot up here. Okay. Just making sure. I heard Travis say, it's hot up here. He didn't say it, but he felt it. So now there's a third son that's on the scene, and he brings up, and this one here confused me a little bit, because not only is this is the third son, but it's spelled differently in different chapters. And not only is he this, but he's also becomes a son of David. He also becomes a mighty warrior. He also does this, that, and the other. So the third son comes on, Sammy. Third son named Sammy shows up. Now Sammy's on the scene, and Sammy's name means Jehovah is there. At the home yesterday, we had a kid whose name was Jehovah, and I'm thinking, I'm like, y'all playing. I said, no, his name really is Jehovah. He had a birthday. I said, Jehovah. He comes up. I said, man, do you have a clue what your name means? Mm-hmm. I said, what does your name mean? He looked at me and mumbled something. I said, man, you don't know what your name means. I said, yes, I do. I said, if you knew what your name means, you would say it with boldness and be proud about it. You're Jehovah. He said, I am Lord. Work it out there, Lord. So now this next one comes on the scene, and this one right here, his father of a vow or his willingness. The sad part is, just because you look the part, just because you have the heart, don't automatically make you the one. Now this third son pulls up, and he is willing. He's willing to do what needs to be done. You know, we can find scriptures all day long where God's looking for a willing vessel. He is the willing vessel. I know I got this. I'm the third one. On the third day, he got up. You know how we start justifying things now. This is, I'm the one. You're not the one either, Travis. Sorry, Sammy. You're not the one. So if you look like it, you have the heart, and you're willing, can you be the one? What someone don't realize is I named three different things, but it was three different people. And the sad part is, there's a lot of people, I come in contact with a lot as a pastor, there's a lot of people that feel that they're ready to lead. But just because you have one or two of the traits don't mean you're ready to lead something. And then God has to nurture some things in you to get you to the place where you're ready to do it. But some of us, just because you had a vision last night don't mean God's ready for you to lead the next morning. You that are dating, he may look like him. He may have the heart. Then you're going to have this one right here, Travis, Sammy, that's willing to put up with you. That's harsh. If y'all would be real, some of you are a handful. I don't care. I'm being honest. Oh, no. Nah, he said, not you, baby. Pastor Paul is available for marriage counseling right after this is over. Some finds one that's willing, but don't have the heart. If you're willing to do something and you don't have the drive to do it, what good is willing to do? It trips me out how many people are willing to go and volunteer but never volunteers. Uh-oh. Or how many have the heart to do it but never do it? Or how many have the strength to do it but never do it? Jesse's son shows up, and out of seven, three of them don't even make the cut. Why? Because they're not the one. I'm about to help someone. All these men were called, but none of them chosen. There's a lot of folks that are called, but only few that are chosen. When you're chosen by God, you don't have an option. When you're chosen by God, even when you try to go the opposite way, you can't go the opposite way because God won't allow you to be that. There's many of you wondering why now, how can God keep forgiving me after I do this, 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 this? Because you're chosen and he ain't going to let you go the opposite way. Why? Because there's something for you to do that no one else can do. And I chose you for it even before you were born. I picked you out of your mother's womb for you to do this work. So the Bible does something real crazy right now. The Bible don't even list these guys' names. It just says, hey, none of y'all the right ones. Go back to your seat. Don't cry on the way there. None of y'all right. That's crazy. All of these men were perfect candidates to do a work, but none of them were the right one. Why is this a lesson in dating? Stop settling just because you want something. If you have to wait 30 years, I ain't waiting no 30 years. If you got to wait, I don't care how long you got to wait. I'd rather wait forever to get forever than to rush to get a few days. Why is the divorce rate so high? Because we don't know. I'm speaking to me. We don't know how to wait. I get asked all the time. I don't care if someone gets offended by this. I get asked all the time. When are you going to get married again? Duh. When God tells me. There's a work that has to be done. And the sad part is, unless you're connected with the right person to do the work, then you yourself will fall off and die. You need the right connection to do what God has called you to do. Let me get here. So now you have all the sons. And I can imagine right now that Samuel is a little bit disappointed. Why is Samuel disappointed? Because God, you told me to go to Jesse's house and to get one of his sons. I've looked at all of his sons and none of them are right. Except for one problem, JJ. He didn't look at all of Jesse's sons. I'm going to insert a little prophecy right here for you. I dare you to look one more time. Someone just missed an opportunity just to give God. I dare you to look. When you feel that there's nothing left and that you, I dare you to look. I'm telling someone even before you leave here today, I dare you to look one more time and watch to see if God has promised it to you. It's there waiting on you, but you're focused on the wrong one and the wrong thing. I'm getting ready. So he tells him, he says, there's something for you to do. There is a son there. And he looks, he said, but this is not any of them. So he said, are these all your sons? This all you have to offer? Jesse says, no. This is not all. I have one more. This one's a little shepherd boy. He's not ready. He's just a kid. Some says 10, some says 15. Either way it go, he's young. He's not ready, Wormy. Samuel tells him to go get him. And he says something that really blessed me. He says, we're not going to even sit down and eat until he gets here. Until the right one's in position, you will not feast at this table. Go and get them. When you put the right one where it needs to be, watch and see what happens. Watch and see what happens. Why is it not doing what it's supposed to do? Because you're bringing me what you think I should have. Give me what I designed. Give me what I desire. Give me what I appointed. Give me what I want to anoint and watch and see. I'll take it where it needs to go. Go get them. Bring them to me. I want to speak for a second on David. When I came to Easley, again, we interviewed several men. And JJ, some were more qualified than others. And there was this one guy that I interviewed. Name was David. Mr. Bill, he was a used car salesman. Didn't have a clue about automotive other than selling the car. And you know how that goes. Me and the fixed operation manager were talking back and forth as to which one is more qualified. He picked this one because this one has more experience. He picked this one because he picked out three. This one here, more experience. This one right here, I think is more teachable. This one right here want the least amount of money. He said, Mark, now you, which one you want? Pick three. I said, I don't need three. I said, I see one that I want. He said, which one? I pointed to the application. I said, I want David. He was like, why you want him? He said, you don't know. He told me, you don't know what I know about him. I said, what do you mean? He said, I worked in Piedmont with him. I know he's an alcoholic. I'm like, no, I didn't know that. He said, I bet you didn't know that he and his wife are going through right now because he was having affairs. I said, no, I didn't know that. The application don't tell all that. He said, I bet you didn't know this about him. Bet you did not. No, I didn't know none of that. So I'm thinking, like, how you know all of that? You've been running around with him, huh? What does that say about you? He said, so who do you want? After saying all the bad things about him. I want David. He said, why do you want David? David is not qualified for what we need. Why do you want him? I don't know. He said, we can't hire nobody based on I don't know. I didn't have an answer. It just felt right inside. Have you ever had to make a decision before and it felt right on the inside? It went against anything you normally would do, but it felt right on the inside and you had to say, God, I'm going to trust you in the midst of this decision no matter how bad it looks. I said, I'm going to stick with David. JJ, we hired his choice. The choice lasted not even 2 weeks, Pastor Paul. He had all the skills, all the knowledge, and everything. But he came in with the wrong attitude. Just because they got all the skills and all the experience and all this, that, and the other, don't make them qualified to do what you need done. We brought him. This first guy came from a big city. You cannot bring a guy from the big city to little old Easley. And God didn't last long. He went to go to the second guy he picked, but that guy had already found a job. Well, I mean, he went to the third one, and that one came in and was stealing. I'm like, good Lord. All the rest were gone. Just so happened David shows up and checking on his application. He said, Mark, what do you think? I said, I told you from day one which one I wanted. We hired him on a trial basis. David came in and had me questioning. Boy, are you sure you saw what you thought you saw? David would go to the car and take a sip. And I'm like, damn, boy, I missed this one. David was everything that the man said he was. But David and I became friends. I was walking a different life than him and doing a different thing. We became friends. And Miss Shirley, David stopped drinking as bad. He wasn't drinking at work no more. He was drinking after work. Some say that's crazy, but you got to give God glory for whatever little you can give him for. David started drinking, and David started making things right with his wife and started doing this, that, and the other. And when it was time for me to leave the job, David wasn't perfect, but he was doing better. The story right here is about a man named David. I hurt for David. David's own father didn't think enough about him to even mention his name. Didn't even think enough about the little shepherd boy. Now, some of you can identify with this, and I'm trying to release you of some hurt. Didn't even think enough about him. He was not good enough. He did not measure up. He did not have the things that his father wanted him to have. It's a hurtful feeling when you try to be there for your daddy or try to be everything your dad wants to be, and all he sees is what you're not. He's willing to put his arms around those that look like him, but not willing to put his arms around you and say, son, I'm proud. I love you. Although, Clark, get on my nerve, and I want to hit him with the back of my gun sometime. Look like that if you want. I'll throw this podium at you. Got me late this morning because he's doing his hair. But you know what? I love him with everything in me. And I don't care what flaws he has. It does not measure up to what's inside of him. And I will take a bullet for my son. And guess what? As a son, you want to know that your father's going to protect you. David don't feel that way. Look at the pits. He chose all the others. I told y'all this one's different for you. I want to get inside your heart real quick. He chose all the others, Miss Shirley, and did not even look at David. Why is this a bad thing? I'm going to point something out to you. All of the first three that were mentioned, Sean, Samson, and Travis, were mighty men of valor. The one Travis represents was truly a warrior. He was the greatest warrior of them all. Why does that mean anything? None of them worked the family business. Go back and read. The father himself, he had sheep. So they all left the family to go and join Saul's army. He had one son left that was dedicated to the family, dedicated to the call. But the sad part is we overlook the one that's dedicated and look at the one that looked the part. Saul, the rest looked like Saul, but David was the shepherd. When he came to find him, where was David? He was in the field with the sheep. Tending to my father's business. We don't choose the one that tends to the father's business. We want to choose the one that looks like what we feel they should look like. My heart aches for David. All I've ever done is want to please you, Daddy. I'm faithful. You won't even pick me. You won't even call me by name. It's sad that I can't even be up here on display with my brothers. I want to point something out, and this is my closing. When God has something for you, He'll find you wherever you are. David wasn't even there on display. He was in the field. When God has a work and has something for you to do, there ain't no devil in hell gonna stop it. I don't care how much they try, they're not gonna stop it. I don't care how much they try to downplay, they're not gonna stop it. I don't care how much they put in front of you, they're not gonna stop. Why? Because you are called to do what you're called to do, and can't nobody stop you because you're called to do just that. I want to point out one more scripture. Galatians. I think she has that also. I want to point this out to you. Why do I want to point this out to you? Because I can imagine David in that field like so many of you. You You know that there's a feast going on that you're not invited to. I've had some of you get upset because I wasn't invited to such and such. Why? I had someone reach out to me, why you didn't tell me about Thursday night? You ain't on the praise team. Duh. Why am I going to tell you about it? Get up there and play a harmonica. I don't care. Be a part of it. And then I'll tell you the next time. David does not have the option to go. That's heartbreaking. Doesn't have the heart. That doesn't have the option, Miss Shirley. Have you ever been to a point where you've done what you know your father has for you to do? And you feel like everyone is still being blessed except you? And you get discouraged because it feels like, God, they ain't even doing what they're supposed to do. And I'm walking the walk that you designed for me to walk, and I'm doing it to the best of my ability, but they're being blessed and I'm not. You ever felt that way before? God had to bless me. He had to tell me something. He said, but I had to fulfill prophecy. I said, what do you mean, God? He said, I told you that the wealth of the unjust was laid up for the just. He said, I had to make sure they get theirs so I can remove them to give it to you. Someone missed it. I had to fulfill prophecy. He said, they're not being blessed before you. He said, I'm letting man know that what you put in front of me is not what I'm going to choose always. So David's in that field and he's hurting. Have you ever been to that point? This scripture blesses me, and this is one that I hold dear to my heart. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. David soweth what? He was dedicated to his father's work. He was determined to do it. And he did it to the best of his ability. So according to scripture, whatsoever you soweth, that shall you reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of his flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary. Oh, I need to help someone with that. Let us not be weary. See, I started this off by telling you all I'm giving you is a word today. We're not going to sit here and try to get you excited today. I'm giving you word. I want to give someone some meat, Derek. Not everyone can get excited about meat. Blake can. All that meat he has. And let us not get weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap. Now watch this. The scripture says, for in due season we shall, not we may, we might, it's a possibility. He said, we shall reap if what? If what? We shall, if we what? Okay, what does that mean? Let me break it down a little bit more for you. I had to look up due season. I said, okay, God, I know how you do. Due season ain't meaning what we think it is. So Ms. Shirley, after doing some research and doing some translating and this, that, and the other, I found that due season, the word due right here, is misrepresented. And Pastor Paul, it's another Hebrew word that I'm not about to try to tell y'all. I'm telling you, I was trying to pronounce it, and I started saying xylophone and x-ray and all kind of crazy stuff. It was all jacked up. I'll post it later, and y'all can go, and I can't even spell it. I got to look it up again and copy it and paste it. It's jacked up. But the word itself meant own. Wormy, the word meant own, not O-N, O-W-N. Now some of y'all gonna understand what it say. So in other words, he said, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in your own season, you shall reap if you faint not. Now, why is this so important? Because those of you that were here back in December, God spoke something over this house. He said that there was a shifting in this house, and that the next 7 years, you were shifting into a new season. Not a new year, but a new season. So what God was speaking to me and I was giving to you is that in due season, in your own season, you shall reap if you faint not. So what does that mean? In other words, David, if you don't give up, if you continue to plow away, even though they're looking at you crazy, if you do what you're supposed to do, in your own season, you will reap. If you faint not. I said, okay, God, how do you know when that season starts? How do we know? He said, look at the words. Blake, you could come on, whoever you bring, whoever you need. I said, how do we know when that season begins? Miss Shirley, he said, what does the scripture say? And let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season, in own season, we shall reap. Come on. If we faint not. So, okay, God, what are you telling me? He said, Mark, what I'm trying to tell you is when you get to the point, Derek, when you're ready to give up and you're ready to throw in a towel, when you get to the point where you can't take it anymore, when you get to the point when you say, you know what, I had enough, God, I'm not doing this anymore. When you get to that breaking point, break. He said, oftentimes we try to stop the break, but I brought the breaking point in your life. Because with that breaking point, I can break loose inside of you. He said, so if, what I mean by this is when you get to the point when you feel like you're about to lose it, go ahead and lose it. I'll be there and I'll pick you up and I'll take you and I'll place you where I need you to be. See, when you get to the point in that due season when you're ready to give up, you lose everything that you have. And God said, I need you to lose some things so I can give you some things. Oh, I'm getting ready to try to help you understand even better. He said, so what I need you to do when you're at this point where you feel like you're about to lose your mind, give me glory. When you feel like that all hell has broken loose against you, give me glory. When you feel like everyone's being blessed except for me, give me glory. He said, when it feels like I'm doing all I can do and I'm not reaping anything, he said, understand that you're right there at the entry point of your due season. Why am I telling you this? Why did I start service without trying to pump you, pride you, or anything else? Because God had to see how many Davids were in the house. Anyone will rise up and look good for the part. When I sit here and try to pump you, anyone will give God glory when someone's making you pump them. But how many of you would be David when no one's telling you to give God glory, when no one's telling, how many of you would be faithful in the field and understand that God has something greater in store for me? How many of you are going to work for your Father even though you're not being recognized? See, it's so easy for us to work for the Father when we're standing up here and we're getting credit, but how many of you are going to work and you're not being recognized for it? How many of you are going to give me your all when your brothers are being chosen over you? How many of you are going to give me glory when it feels like you're losing your mind? God said, he said, I need you to understand. When you feel like you're about to quit, dig one more time. Why? Do I need you to dig one more time? Because this last one is the one where you start pulling out of the field. What am I telling New Image Church? What are we going to get? We're going to get the promises of God that's on your life. I don't care what your mother said. I don't care what your father said. I don't care who have left you. God got you right where he wants you. And he told me to tell you, don't you get weary in well-doing, for in your own season. See, here's the thing about your own season, Miss Shirley. Your own season is your season. Wormy, your own season is your season. Nicole, your own season is your season. No one else's. The reason why, Miss Shirley, many others can be placed there is because they think that it's their season. But it wasn't theirs. It was David's season. What did this have to do with David? My friend David, Miss Shirley, when I left the place, the reason I won't call the place the automotive shop here, because he still works there and I don't want anyone. But Miss Shirley, when I left, I went and opened my own automotive shop. When I went and opened my own automotive shop, I did that for several years, and Vaughn wound up getting back into the dealership. And one day I was at John Finger Mazda in Greenville. They said, Mark, you got a call. I'm like, nobody gonna call me here. Everyone got my cell phone. So I went. The person on the other line, me and David had this crazy way of talking to each other. We'd be like, you big dummy. I mean, that's how we just talk. I said, hello. The person said, it didn't sound. I said, hello. The person paused for a second. I heard a chuckle in the background. I said, whoever this is, I'm about to hang up. He said, you big dummy. I said, David, what's going on, man? He said, man, I'm doing good. He said, why you didn't tell me you were getting back in the dealership? I said, because honestly, I was tired of being my own boss. Why? He said, man, you should have told me. I said, why? He said, I'm the service manager now. I would have brought you back and made you my right hand. I hired him years ago, and now he's ready to hire me back. Miss Shirley, the same one they didn't believe in was the very same one that became. But Pastor Paul, it didn't stop there. Miss Shirley, he worked, and all of a sudden, I noticed on Facebook, because, you know, you can have friends that you unfortunately don't get to spend time with like you'd like to. And then there's also friends that you grow in different direction. I'm still there if you need me. We're going in two different ways. I still love you, but I can't go the path you're going. I looked and realized, I said, he's in North Carolina. He was in Hickory for a little bit. He was the service manager there, Miss Shirley. And then he wound up being in Charlotte at the dealership in Charlotte, Honda in Charlotte, my service manager. About 3 years ago, I saw a post on Facebook. Said, easily, I'm back. I said, man, my dog David's back. What's going on? But I looked at his title on Facebook. And Pastor Paul, it didn't say service manager anymore. Carol, it didn't say fixed operation manager. His title said general manager. Not only did he excel in the company, he became the general manager of the company, and he came back to Easley to run the Easley store. But less than a year ago, I got a message. He said, man, I'm getting ready to leave. We hadn't had lunch yet. I said, what's going on? He said, man, they're sending me back to Charlotte. I said, again? He said, yeah. I said, why are you going back to Charlotte? He said, man, they're giving me property in all three of the stores. I'm part owner. No one believed in him, but there was something on the inside of me said, give him a chance. There's many of you here right now that won't give someone a chance because they're not this, that, or the other. But I'm telling that person that's on the other side, don't get weary in well doing, for in your own season you shall reap.
if you faint not. New Image Church, I speak a prophetic word over this house. There'll be some that wants to rejoice, but you didn't put in the work, you can't rejoice. Miss Pat, you can rejoice. Matter of fact, that whole row can rejoice. Last year, although we talked about a great big God, we had a great big enemy that was testing us. And many of us had separation anxiety and everything else. But here God said when he spoke that word over this house in December, that this house shifted. Where did we shift? We shifted into our due season. What does that mean? It's harvest time. It's harvest time. Now, some of you can't get excited about it because you ain't planted nothing. Now, only those that really planted something can get excited right now. Mr. Buddy, Miss Judy, y'all can get excited because you planted. There's several in here that can get excited because you planted. So what am I getting excited about? You getting ready to reap of harvest is that you planted? But that's not it. I heard God said in this season, because you got on board at the right time, you're getting ready to reap of harvest you didn't even have nothing to do with. So what am I saying to you? Some of you getting ready to receive because other people planted and because you got connected at the right time. I'm here to declare right now that this house, this is your due season. David, it's your turn to shine. There are many here today that feel like David. I'm trying to move on, but I feel your pain. I feel your hurt. I don't know who you are, but I know I feel your hurt. And the thing about your hurt is, it's funny. I got to move. I got to be obedient. The thing about your hurt is funny. The reason I laugh, because if you ever understood how close you are to your breakthrough. In other words, I see keys in the future, and the keys are getting ready to unlock some things that's been locked up. There's some happiness that's been gone there. I don't know, but I hear these words where God spoke to Lazarus and told Lazarus, come forth. There's been some things in your life that's been dead, and I hear God said, I'm commanding it to come forth. You at a place right now where you can go and claim your blessings. I hear God said, speak life to him. Don't speak death. I don't care what it looks like. Not only her, there's several in here right now. Stop looking through the natural eye and start looking through the spiritual eye. You are blessed. Your house is blessed. The kids are blessed. Your husband's blessed. Oh, I wish I had some believers. Due season. Due season. Due season. What about me, God? It's been a rough season for me. What about me? What about me? What about me? God, I'm hurting. I'm this, I'm that, I'm this, that, and the other. God said, but guess what? I still got you. And he got his arms around you. Oh, there's so much on the inside. So much has happened. I wish he would have even allowed me to. So much. And you don't even, it's hard to even trust people. Every time I let my guard down and trust, someone hurts me, someone backstabs me, someone takes from me. Someone recently just came in and took some things, and not only took some physical things, but took part of you away. But the one thing I know about when God allows someone to take something from me, when I started out, God said that was just for you. Anything that you recently lost, he said, I took for a reason. Because I'm getting ready to give it back to you. And when I give it back to you, I'm giving it in abundance. Listen. You won't have, I wish, listen, I need believers in here right now to rejoice over these words. You will not have room enough to receive what he's getting ready to do. There are many in here that can identify with David. And you needed this to recharge you. But I'm speaking to those of you that were at your breaking point right now. If you were at your breaking point where you felt like you had nothing left to offer and you felt like you were ready to give up, I need you to come to the altar for me. Just come. We're wrapping up. Again, camera folks, when you got to, you turn it off. I don't care. If you were at your breaking point, you felt you've lost all and you have nothing else to offer, come to the altar real quick. Real quick. Real quick. Real quick. Brother, I'm telling you, I don't have a clue who you are, but one thing I do know is every step that you just took was ordered by God. Yeah. And listen, this is the thing that I like the most. You didn't let what you heard stop you from coming. I expected, you know, more to... Because let's just be honest for a second. Not all word about our church is good word. There's some people, Vaughn, that's been hurt by us. That had some negative things to say. But you didn't even let that hold you back. I don't have a clue who you are, what you are, or anything. But I do know there were several points in the sermon today that actually identified with you. And the reason it identified with you is because the moment you opened that door, I heard God said, I opened some things that were locked off in your life. And not only did I open some things that were locked off in your life, he said, I'm restoring some things. Listen, oh God, I hear you. I gotta finish this. I gotta finish this. Listen, what some don't realize, I just wish I had men in church that would see a man crying and understand it's okay. It's okay. But there's something I did not tell many. And I'm going to say these words to you. The Bible says that Jesse sent forth seven sons. We know the number seven means all this good stuff. But none of the seven were chosen. I don't know what your name is, but I'm going to start calling you number eight. Why am I calling you number eight? Because it was the eighth son that received the anointing, that received the blessing. Now, I wish I had more people that would declare to themselves, I'm number eight. Why? Because the number eight represents resurrection and reconstruction and ordering things. Why am I saying that? God said, I'm resurrecting in your life. I'm resurrecting in your life. And who are you here with today? This gentleman? Come here. I'm going to need you to do something in a second, because this is going to release you from years of hurt also when you do it. The heart is pure, but there's some things that happen you got to release first. And the reason you got to let it go first is because if you don't, the same thing will happen. But I hear God said, I'm trying to bring a newness out of you. Not trying, God, I'm sorry. I put words in your mouth. He said, I'm doing a new in you. And I'm going to have her in a second. I just want her to lay her hands on you right here. And the reason I want her to do that, because David was declared a man after God's own heart. And the reason why David was declared a man after God's own heart is not because David was perfect, but because David did what he was supposed to. He was about his father's business. Making God happy was important to him. Someone else need to hear this. He still was an adulterer. He was a murderer. He was all this, that, and the other. And God declared him to be a man after God's own heart. I figured more people that are struggling like the Apostle Paul struggled would get excited about that, because I know that's my testimony, that God, even when I set out to do good, evil is present and trying to pull me back. You got to know words to get excited about it. Why am I saying that? Because I believe that the enemy desire is to tear you down based on your past. But that won't happen. I need you to pray the prayer that David prayed. Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Oh, I wish I had some believers. Listen, right there where you're at, if you're sitting by your significant other, your husband, your boo thing, whatever you want to call it, I need you to lay hands on him and she lay hands, and I need you to say, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit. God's wanting to do a new thing in this church, and until we get ready to do something new won't happen. This is my closing prayer. Oh, I love, man, I wish. Simply come on up here and put hands on your husband while he's playing. Why? Because God's elevating even him right now. Those of you that got a significant other that's working, you got my permission to go to him and lay hands on him. Begin to pray for him right now. Begin to pray for him. 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 Why is it important? Why is it important? Speak life. Speak life. Speak life. For in due season, listen, in due season, you shall reap. If you faint not, in other words, keep plugging. The Bible says that when David showed up, he did not show up consecrated like the rest. He did not show up clean like the rest, Pastor Blake. But he showed up and he still had the feces on him. He was still dirty. He was not prepared. But God looked at him and said, you are the one. What am I telling you, New Image? I hear God say, you are the one. I picked David. Now put your name there. Begin to speak life. Father, bless your people. See the need of them. As we leave your place of worship, but not from your presence, allow your anointing to rest, rule, and abide in them. We give you praise, we give you honor, we give you glory. Let them not leave your house of worship until they receive your anointing. Because it was the anointing that was placed upon David that destroyed all yoke. And right now, God, we need your anointing. We need your touch to do this work. We bless you. We love you. We give you praise, honor, and glory. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name. Go ahead. I love it.
To me,
hug someone and tell them that you love them as you leave this place.
Hug them
and let them know you.